Luke chapter 22. As we continue in this series in the Gospel of Luke, we will be in verses 1 through 38 this morning of Luke 22. If you need a Bible, there are ones in front of you. Otherwise, turn and click swipe tap. If you use one of these Bibles, it's on page 573. Now, the Feast of Unleavened Bread drew near, which is called the Passover. And the chief priests and the scribes were seeking how to put him to death, for they feared the people. Then Satan entered Judas, called Iscariot, who was of the number of the 12. He went away and conferred with the chief priests and officers how he might betray him to them. And they were glad and agreed to give him money. So he consented and sought an opportunity to betray him to them in the absence of the crowd. Then came the day of unleavened bread, on which the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed. So Jesus sent Peter and John, saying, "Go and prepare the Passover for us, that we may eat it." They said to him, "Where will you have us prepare it?" He said to them, "Behold, when you have entered the city, a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him into the house that he enters, and tell the master of the house, 'The teacher says to you, where is the guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large upper room furnished. Prepare it there." And they went and found it, just as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover. And when the hour came to recline at table, the apostles with him, and he said to them, "I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God." He took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he said, "Take this and divide it among yourselves. For I tell you that from now on I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." He took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And likewise, the cup, after they had eaten, saying, "This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. But behold, the man who betrays me is with me on the table. The Son of Man goes as it has been determined. But woe to that man by whom he is betrayed." And they began to question one another, which of them it could be who was going to do this. A dispute also arose among them as to which of them was to be regarded as the greatest. But he said to them, "The kings of the Gentiles exercise lordship over them, and those in authority over them are called benefactors. But not so with you. Rather, let the greatest among you become as the youngest, and the leader as one who serves. For who is greater, one who reclines at table or one who serves? Is it not the one who reclines at table? But I am among you as the one who serves. Yet you are the ones who have stayed with me in my trial, and I assign you, as my Father assigned to me, a kingdom, that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom, and sit on thrones judgment for the tribes of Israel. Simon, Simon, behold, Satan has demanded to have you, that he might sift you like wheat. But I have prayed for him, when you have turned again, strengthen your brothers." Peter said to him, "Lord, I am ready to go with you both to prison and to death." Jesus said, "I tell you, Peter, the rooster will not crow this day until you deny 3 times that you know me." And he said to them, "When I sent you out with no money bag or knapsack or sandals, did you lack anything?" They said, "Nothing." He said to them, "But now, let the one who has a money bag take it, and likewise a knapsack. And let the one who has no sword sell his cloak and buy one. For I tell you that this scripture must be fulfilled in me, and he was numbered with the transgressors. So it is written about me has its fulfillment." And they said, "Look, Lord, here are 2 swords. And he said to them, "It is enough." My notes out already. You know, there are times in life when we feel drawn the people around us, and you know, usually these instances involve two things: a shared experience on one hand, and then usually a momentous experience, a shared momentous experience. When you share something really profound and significant with others, it has a way of binding you, has a way of knitting your hearts together in a way that becomes in some ways inseparable. And the more harrowing the experience, the more it seems to draw a group together. So you face tragedy, or you face death, or narrowly escape death. There's a part of you that will never be separated. And sometimes these experiences are obvious in the moment, but other times their momentousness or their significance, their impact is only recognized later. I suspect that that's how Jesus' disciples may have recalled this episode in Luke 22, 1 through 38. All four of Jesus' biographers, the gospel writers, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, record the story of Jesus' last meal with his disciples. It's a meal that both foreshadows what is to come and prepares them for it. And we memorialize this meal, as we did last week, as the Lord's Supper, because it was instituted and commanded by the Lord Jesus Christ. But this wasn't the first Lord's Supper. In many ways, it was the last Passover. And through this shared, momentous experience, Jesus prepared a Passover people. Jesus prepared a Passover people. And in this passage, we're going to see that there are at least six marks of a Passover people. The first mark of a Passover people is that they exist in a hostile time. You know, around 1500 B.C., we don't know the exact date, somewhere between 1500 and 1250 B.C., there was a king over Egypt who grew suspicious and fearful of these Hebrews that were living in the land. He enslaved them, and he tried to depress their population by slaughtering their male children. And when he died, his successor was no less ruthless. And when God sent a prophet, Moses, to the king to ask him to allow the Israelites to worship God in the wilderness, the king increased the burdens on the people and stubbornly refused. The hardships got harder, and the Israelites' hope grew dim, and the situation was bleak. They were evil times leading up to what was the first Passover, as Liz recently just came into a read for us. Likewise, the days grew evil leading up to what was in many ways the last Passover. So the chief priests and the scribes were seeking how put Jesus to death. Just as Pharaoh had tried to destroy Israel in the age leading up to Passover, so the religious leaders of Jerusalem were trying to destroy the new and better Israel, Jesus, in the age leading to this Passover. And there can be no doubt of the evil of this moment, because this rare biblical character, Satan, appears on the scene. Luke records that then Jesus entered into Judas, called Iscariot. Satan does not appear in the Bible very much. You might be surprised by that, by how much he comes up in sort of popular culture. It's a very minor character. The only other time we see him active in Jesus' life is just before the start of his public ministry. There in Luke 4, we see the devil tempting Jesus to deny God and the calling on his life. And when Jesus thwarts him, Luke tells us that Satan departed from him until an opportune time. That opportune time is the kairos. It might be a Greek word you've heard thrown around sometimes a little too much. But that's the Greek word behind the opportune time, the kairos. In verse 6, we read that Judas, now animated by Satan, is looking for an opportunity, a eukairos, a particularly opportune time. And so this is a foreboding background to everything that happens. This is the context in which Jesus' followers come together in this passage, a hostile world, ultimately bent on rejecting and destroying Jesus. It remains the same today. A Passover people come together against the backdrop of evil and hostility. We've seen it this past week, haven't we? The turkey has begun attacking some of the parties in the long-standing Syrian civil war. A German man fired upon a Jewish synagogue, killing two. We can read stories of migrants fleeing to Europe, being captured by Libyans and abused by the Libyans with funding and support from the European Union. We see protests in Hong Kong have turned violent. There is beauty in our world, but so often it is marred with sin and it can be overwhelming. But in the midst of this hostility, in the midst of this evil, in the midst of this bleakness and darkness, and what might feel like hopelessness, a Passover people is born. Coming together not because of the world, but in spite of the world. In spite of the darkness. In spite of the gloom, in spite of the pain and the suffering, never forgetting that it is real. The Passover people can't forget that the suffering is real. It knows that this evil is ultimately directed at its leader, Jesus, whether the world realizes that or not. And because of that, the Passover people cannot ignore evil, cannot shut their minds off to it, cannot pretend that it doesn't exist. There's a difference between gathering in ignorance of the pain of the world. There's a difference between gathering with our ears plugged and our eyes blindfolded. And us gathering because we know the world is evil. And we know that that evil has even tainted our own hearts. And so we come together spite of it, in contrast to it. I can remember my freshman year at the University of Illinois, and I was involved in the campus ministry, and the campus ministry had gotten rather large, and they had bought out a bar on Green Street. Green Street was it was the bar scene in at the University of Illinois. 6th and Green, that was where you went to get drunk, and they had been able to renovate the bar, and so when we met at this renovated bar, and you know, we'd get out, we'd play loud Christian music, worshiping, and there was this feeling, there was this sense of this, that it was kind of in the midst of the darkest part of campus, and yet in the midst of the darkest part of campus, we were gathering together despite the world. And there was something about that that was binding to us. We had a shared experience recognizing that when we left those doors, things were not always comfortable for us on campus. Things were not always serene. We were sometimes mocked or sometimes made fun of or whatever else. But when we were there, there was a solidarity despite the lawlessness and the revelry and the debauchery that surrounded us. There's something like that happens when we gather on Sunday mornings, in particular, in those Sundays when we celebrate the Lord's Supper. We don't celebrate it in ignorance of the world, but because the world is evil, because we know that our hearts are marred by evil, we gather together in spite of it, and we are bonded together in the midst of suffering. So a Passover people is marked by its gathering in a hostile world. The second mark of a Passover people is that it comes together at the direction of Jesus. And this is significant for a couple reasons. That in the Old Testament, amidst this dark background of Egypt, God tells the Israelites through Moses that he will deliver them. And when the time of their deliverance was almost at hand, God gives instructions on how they were to prepare. They were to eat this meal. They were to kill a lamb for the meal, spread some of its blood on the doorposts, the lintels. God was going to come through the land of Egypt and destroy every firstborn male. But every family that demonstrated faith in God by obeying this instruction would be passed over by God's angel of destruction. Hence, it was Passover. They were to eat the lamb roasted with bitter herbs. It was a reminder of their bitter circumstances in an evil world. They were to eat it with unleavened bread, with sandals on, and dressed as if ready to leave for a journey. They were about to embark on a journey. The bread was to be unleavened because it wasn't going to have time to rise. It was a meal to be eaten in haste quickly, because once God destroyed the firstborn, the Israelites would be forced to leave Egypt quickly. And so God laid out all the ways in which the Israelites were to prepare for the meal. In verse 8, we have Jesus commanding two disciples, Peter and John, go and prepare the Passover for us that we may eat it. And they ask him, where do you have us prepared? And that's a reasonable question, because Jerusalem, as I understand it, there's debate about how large Jerusalem was at this time, and the range of estimates is pretty significant. But what everyone seems to agree on is that during the major festivals, the population of Jerusalem could swell by hundreds of thousands. And if they had not made preparations by this point, where becomes a very good question. Behold, when you've entered the city, a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him into the house that he enters and tell the master of the house, the teacher says to you, where is the guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples? And he will show you a large upper room furnished. Prepare it there. Jesus knew exactly what was necessary to prepare the Passover. And he directs his disciples exactly to get ready. So Jesus is creating a new Passover, and its people are called by Jesus. Jesus was a prophet, seeing things that he could not have seen, but he's also God in the flesh, giving command as to how this meal shall be taken, just as Yahweh commanded the Israelites of old how they should take their meal. If the Passover meant fidelity to Yahweh, faithfulness to Yahweh's word, then this new Passover people would be marked by fidelity to Jesus and faithfulness to Jesus' word. And so what marks you off as part of a Passover people is that Jesus has instructed you, made you, set you apart by his word, your faithful response to his word. And that brings us to the third mark of a Passover people. At the first Passover in Exodus 12, the Israelites were commanded to take a lamb for each household. It was important that the entire lamb be consumed. So if there was anything left over, it had to be burned up. And if a family was too small to eat an entire lamb, then they would share it with some nearby neighbors. But essentially, it was a family meal. By eating the Passover meal with his 12 apostles, Jesus was marking them off as a new family. This is the third mark of a Passover people. They are and form a new family. Against the backdrop of a hostile world, Jesus' disciples would be a new family unit. Jesus' mother is not there, nor are his brothers and sisters there. Yes, he had brothers and sisters. We don't even see Peter's own wife there. We don't see James and John's parents, who are referenced at times during Jesus' life, there. That's in fact the only biological family that's there, right, is James and John, who happen to be brothers. This new family is not connected by blood. It is not connected by marriage. Rather, it's connected by Jesus, who is the central figure here. He is the head of the household. He is leading this meal. He is controlling this set of circumstances. He has orchestrated this set of circumstances. He has brought this about. He has called these 12. And so this new family, it's recognized, again, not by blood or by marriage, but by the person of Jesus. The outside world rejects Jesus, but those at the table are those who accept Jesus on his terms as Lord, as King, as Messiah, and more presently, as Lamb. Let's consider how they eat the meal. Although this is a Passover meal, no mention is made of the lamb. I assume they had one, but I think the lamb faded into the background because the true and better lamb was at the center of the table. Rather, Jesus references two aspects of the meal. First, Jesus references the wine. This was not part of what was required for Passover meal in Exodus 12, but it would have been common at any Jewish meal. You drank wine. There's debate about whether the Jewish Seder, the ritual order of the Passover feast that Jews follow today, had been developed by this time. And so sometimes Christians will want to recreate the Jewish Seder and reenact what may have happened at the Lord's Supper. Specifically, the Jewish Seder calls for four cups of wine, and some wonder which one of the four cups Jesus is using here. Here's the thing, we simply don't know. We simply don't know whether or not Jesus and his disciples knew of this ritual in the first century AD. We don't have a clear idea of history, whether it was before this or after this that the Jews developed this custom. Or maybe it existed in some small part. It doesn't matter. It's not what's emphasized here. What is important is that the disciples share the cup of wine. They drink from one cup, unifying them. And then they share the bread, again, unifying them. Jesus says, the bread, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. One piece of bread broken and shared among the 12 of them. Jesus was quite clearly, a bit of an aside, but not literally calling the bread his body. After all, Jesus' body was standing right in front of them. So when Jesus says, this is my body, they're not going, wait a second, is it there or is it there in your hand? Which is, they're not confused about this. They would have understood it symbolically as we ought to, but given for them. Similarly, the cup, this cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. These words, new covenant, are significant. These Passover people would be a covenant people. They would be bound together on the basis of Jesus' blood, not the blood of a lamb, an ovine. Jesus was about to have his body hung up on a cross, his blood poured out on the grounds of civil and religious authorities of first century Jerusalem, but it was not to be done in vain. It wasn't an empty death. Jesus says he does it for you. He does it on behalf of his disciples. Jesus' death was a sacrifice given on behalf of his followers. By the means of his sacrifice, they become one people, one family. Why a sacrifice and a Passover? Well, here we might let the prophet John the Baptist tell us. He calls Jesus the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. That is, he is the sacrifice that pays for and removes the sins of all those who come to him. You know, sitting at this table with Jesus is a fairly ragtag group of men that includes a cheat, Levi the tax collector, a couple of fishermen, revolutionary, zealot, another assorted folk, ordinary guys, rough and tumble, some of them. They weren't great in the eyes of the world. They weren't special in the eyes of the world. They weren't the guys who would make a name for themselves otherwise. And some of them were quite obviously sinners. They were all sinners. We are all sinners, but some of these folk were really, on the surface, bad dudes. And our sin creates a barrier with the God who made us so that we cannot enjoy him. We cannot be with him, but we earn ourselves an eternal death by our unrighteousness. The things we do wrong, the things that we think wrong, the things that we speak wrong, that insult and offend God. And so Jesus took the punishment of sin, the punishment that the sins of the world ought to pay on himself on behalf of you, on behalf of his disciples. So that those who come to him, those who choose to follow him in faith and repentance of their sins, have this sacrifice, have this death appropriated on their behalf so they can be forgiven, so they can have new life, no matter what they did. The revolutionary can be forgiven. The tax cheat can be forgiven. The fishermen who probably had sailors' mouths can be forgiven. Whatever sin you have committed, it too can be forgiven. It might not be forgiven in the eyes of the world. You might not ever be able to have a name made for yourself, but it can be forgiven by the blood of the Lamb who takes away the sin of the world. To be part of Jesus' Passover people is to be made in the new family that is covenanted in his blood. Of course, around any family, every family, eventually if you get out enough rungs, right, there's someone who doesn't belong. Probably, if you think about your extended family, there's someone who does not fit in your extended family. Maybe that person who doesn't fit in is you. Someone who over time proves that they don't have the interests or the care of the family in mind. So although Jesus states the wine is a new covenant with his new family, he's quick to reference Judas, but behold the hand of him who betrays me is with me on the table. It's not always obvious who the imposters are. But Jesus knows who they are, and in time they will be revealed. But the third mark of a Passover people is that they are a new family, because they have come to the body and blood of Jesus. This leads to a discussion among the disciples about who's going to be the betrayer. Who is going to be this one that Jesus is talking about? And then a debate strikes up about who is the greatest. And it doesn't say if you could imagine one of these leading to the other. Perhaps James got agitated and said, well, I'd never betray him. After all, I'm the most loyal disciple. To which everyone turned and stared at him for a minute until Matthew opens his mouth and says, now wait a minute, no one gave up more to follow him than I did, and what's more, I'm older. And then Peter says, sure, fine, but I was first. However it happens, there was an argument. And Jesus says that this jockeying of position, that's what the nations, that's what the world does. But it's not, it's precisely not how his followers should points to his own example. Obviously, in life, he says that the one who's seated at the table is more important than the one waiting on the table, the one serving the meal. But he is the one who's serving them. He's divided the bread. He's handed it out. He's passed out the wine. And he is the one who's about to go to the cross and die for them. And so the greatest is really the servant. The idea of service here is the word that gives us deacon. It's not the service of a slave, but it was considered menial work in Roman society. But Jesus underlines that this is born out of a familial love, a family-centered love. And this is the fourth mark of a Passover that they are servants of one another. It's a service that is born out of familial love, but they serve one another. And their service will end in their being served in Jesus' kingdom. So the service, they're being served by Jesus at this meal, is a foreshadowing of a time when Jesus' kingdom will be inaugurated, when it will be made full and whole, and it will come in all of its glory, and they will be served there. So now and that day, however long it comes. And we saw last week that there will be a time, there will be a duration of time between the inroads of the kingdom into this world and its culmination, the end of history. The thing that marks off Jesus' Passover people between now and then is that they sin, is that they humble themselves, is that they take the position of the youngest, take the position of the lowest, take the position of the weakest. They're afraid to get their hands dirty. They aren't afraid to surrender themselves, born out of a love that they have for one another. Satan, who had taken Judas, has asked permission to sift Peter like wheat. The point seems clear. Peter will be tested severely. But, and this is a big but, Jesus has prayed for him. And that's ultimately the protection that will keep Simon Peter in the faith. A Passover people. Peter's failing, as most of you know, was deep. We'll get there in a few weeks. He is asked simple questions about whether he is an associate of Jesus. It would have been the first century equivalent of somebody asking you, are you really one of those Christians? He cannot bring himself to acknowledge this simple. He says he's ready to go to prison and death for Jesus, but nothing could be further from the truth. I often wonder about persecution. What would I do? How would I respond? In fact, I often think of it this way. How will I respond? Because I feel ever more convicted that there is a trajectory that our culture is on that very well may lead to a more significant and traditional level of persecution. This temporary blip in history that we have experienced in our country is quite the aberration. And I don't know that it will last forever. It seems to me that certain cultural moves align with an atmosphere that and I don't know how far it will go in my life or yours, but when it happens, will I go? Will I go against it? I think, like Peter, we like to think big of ourselves. No, oh, not me. I'd go. I'd stand tall for Jesus. But these things are easy to say when there aren't spears, and clubs, and mobs, and violence. And our hearts are enormously don't judge ourselves rightly a lot of time. And that's a scary, sobering thought. But there's this encouragement. Peter is about to fall, but he never falls away. He fails, but his faith does not fail. The author of Hebrews writes in chapter 7, verse 25, and we even sang about it in our opening song this morning. Consequently, he is able to save to the uttermost those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. Jesus will not allow his chosen ones to fall away. He says, when you have turned again, Peter, strengthen your brothers. Jesus did not say, if you turn again, Peter. He says, when you turn again. Jesus promises that the one who endures to the end will be saved. Peter endures to the end. How? No, not by his own strength. Not by his own power. He proves that within a few hours of this night. But he does it by the strength of Christ on his behalf. He he fell. And for a time, he's going to look like an unbeliever. He's going to look like an apostate. For a time, he's going to look like Satan has done to him what he did to Judas. But his faith will not fail, not entirely. And in time, Peter will do just this. He will go to jail. He will go before authorities. He will receive beatings and insults in the name of Jesus. And ultimately, he will be killed for this Jesus. He will hold you fast. Because a Passover people is protected by Jesus. And so, he will endure to the end. That leads to the last mark of a Passover people that we see in this text. The sixth mark of a Passover people is that they are prepared for persecution. Jesus recounts the times he sent his disciples out in pairs. You can read about those if you don't remember in Luke 9, Luke 10. And their mission was to preach the good news, the same message that Jesus was preaching, expand his ministry, and heal as Jesus had been healing. And Jesus had them travel light, relying on the hospitality of those they met and came into contact with. Those who welcomed the good news would support their ministry for the time being. They weren't to accumulate riches for themselves from this ministry, but trust that God would provide each day what they needed. But these new instructions suggest a time of scarcity, a time when hospitality of strangers is going to be hard to come by. In fact, the hospitality is going to turn to hostility. So he brings up the image of the sword. The reason for the new instruction is that Jesus himself is going to be treated as a common criminal. He's about to go to his own death. And so violence is going to come on his family. It's not hard to look around the world and see that. We pray for the Syrian Christians and Kurdish Christians this morning who face intense persecution. Syria, both Syria and Turkey, two of the leading persecuting nations in the world. So to have them at war with Christians in the middle is certainly difficult for our brothers and sisters. We can go around the globe and we pray for them regularly, but persecution has come upon the church. And it comes upon the church soon after Jesus leaves this earth. You can read about that in Luke's second volume in the book of Acts, how much persecution comes upon Jesus' family, comes upon this Passover people. And in the same way, the first Passover people, the Israelites, when they gained their freedom from Egypt, found themselves suddenly persecuted as Pharaoh had a change of heart, pursued hard after them, ready to destroy them in his rage. But God rescues his people. No, he won't necessarily rescue, save your life in this world, but as we looked at last week, Jesus makes this incredible promise in chapter 21. You'll be delivered up even by parents and brothers and relatives and friends, and some of you they will put to death. You'll be hated by all for my name's sake, but not a hair of your head will perish. By your endurance, you will gain your lives. What an amazing thought. Though we be put to death, not a hair of our head will perish. That there's hope for a resurrection, life, and that in the final tally, God will rescue his people. So these six marks of a Passover people, though, you can take them a couple different ways. One way you can take them, and I hope that you do take them if you are a follower of Jesus Christ, is that these things should characterize you and those Christians you associate with and in a local church, wherever you are, wherever you from. We have visitors from all over the place this morning. And so wherever your church is, these things should mark you and the people you gather with, the people you celebrate the Lord's Supper with. And to the extent that they don't, that, you know, should be, oh boy, man, we gotta do better with that. We need to look at it. But the flip side of that is they can also be a diagnostic as to whether, well, maybe I have deceived myself. Take the first mark, for example, that we live in evil times. There's a certain recognition that the church gathers amidst hostility. We recognize that the general course of this world is in opposition to Jesus. If you don't recognize that, if you don't recognize the general course of the world is in opposition to Jesus, not that every individual act of the world is as against Jesus as it possibly could be, but the general course of the universe is set in sin against Jesus, then it could very well be that you love the world more than you love Jesus. It might be an indication that you are not part of Christ's Passover people. If you have not come to Jesus, if you haven't recognized that second mark, that Passover people are made by Jesus, and so you have not followed his instructions and seen him as your author and leader and Lord, it's a good indication that perhaps you're not belong to his Passover people. If you do not see his church, your church, as the new family of Christ, bought and purchased by his blood, that's a problem. That could be dangerous. It could indicate that you do not understand what it means to have been bought by the blood of Jesus. To the extent that we gateway do not act like a family, it is an indictment on us for not being who Christ has called us to be. To the extent that we do not have our lives marked by a love of service and a service of love for one another, that we do not recognize the humility that sets us in the lowest place, even as Jesus, who was God himself, lowered himself to take on our form in all of its weakness, and went further than that to wait tables on his followers, who went further than that to die and shed his blood and be humiliated and disfigured and mutilated and killed by his followers. If our lives aren't marked by such a loving, humble service, we may be indicting ourselves that we are not a Passover. And so too, our love for one another must overflow with a deep and abiding service. If you fall away, we remember that Passover people is protected by Jesus. Jesus prays for Peter that he will not finally fail, but he offers no support to Jesus. This is one point we want to see in hindsight. There will be those who look like they belong to the family, who belong to the church of Jesus Christ, who belong to a Passover people, who fall. ways, the persecution we face in our country is a bit like the persecution that was faced by Peter on the night when Jesus was betrayed. You too are one of his followers, aren't you? That's about the extent of the persecution we get in this country. So we prepare ourselves for persecution. We recognize it is ahead. We soberly assess our hearts, recognizing their weakness, praying for Christ by his Spirit to give us the strength to endure persecution, however light or heavy it may come, because to ourselves we don't. And ourselves will simply go like Peter did.